I draw the line in the dust and toss the gauntlet before the feet of tyranny, and I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
Ain't gonna let nobody turn me around, turn me around, turn me around.
All the people, the big people and the little people throughout this land, have awakened to the fact that they have a right.
Judge Julius Waring's lone dissent in the 1952 Briggs v. Elliott case forced the issue of school segregation to the Supreme Court and initiated the reversal of Plessy v. Ferguson. Waring's bold actions in a deeply segregated America broke the barriers to desegregation in American schools with the passage of Brown v. the Board of Education.
After the ratification of the 13th Amendment, the fight against segregation had just begun. In 1883, the Supreme Court ruled that the Civil Rights Act of 1875 was unconstitutional, and the 1896 Supreme Court ruling of Plessy v. Ferguson upheld and solidified constitutionalized segregation in America. This laid the foundation for the birth of Jim Crow and the passage of Black Codes, state laws that oppressed blacks. For the next half century, separate but equal would be used as an excuse for segregation and racism, creating barriers between people living in a newly united America. In the 1940s, Charleston was the center of South Carolina's economy. The Charleston Naval Shipyard was an important military base, and the city council introduced the nation's first historic district, promoting pride and preservation. But the culture of Charleston was similar to that of most southern cities, stubborn and intolerant. Modern segregation reigned and left the South with even more hate than it already had towards African Americans. Family and culture passed racism down each generation. Children were taught to hate those different from them. White supremacist activity was at an all-time high during the mid-1950s, and violence in the South was commonplace. In a once glamorous and forward-thinking town, now engulfed in hatred and closed-mindedness, a U.S. district judge would use the legal system and his position to break the barriers of segregation.
After standing up for his civil rights against a white bus driver in 1946, Sergeant Isaac Woodard was unjustly arrested, brutally beaten with a blackjack, and intentionally blinded. Sergeant Woodard's case, Batesburg v. Shull, began in the U.S. District Court in Charleston, South Carolina. On the bench was Judge Julius Wades Waring. Woodard's trial consisted of an all-white jury who took a mere 28 minutes to deliberate. After hearing the gruesome narrative of a decorated war hero's encounter with a racist police chief, Judge Waring's patrician view on segregation began to crumble. Gripped by Woodard's story and the evidence of Jim Crow's brutal handiwork, he determined that he could either remain entirely governed by the doctrine of white supremacy or break that barrier and be a federal judge and decide the law. As Judge Richard Gergel, author of Unexampled Courage, stated,
One of the most important parts of Judge Waring's sort of contribution to this is that he broke this monopoly of silence. And he woke up watching that trial. It was his baptism of fire. He just suddenly said, you know, this is wrong.
Judge Waring made it his personal pursuit to stare into the abyss of racism in America. Waring dug in, spending his evenings reading An American Dilemma, a 1,400-page Carnegie Institute study of racism. Next was Mind of the South, a 1941 historical account of the enormous difficulties of getting the white people of the South to confront their own problems. His intense study of race resulted in a new sense of meaning of the judge's function in a democratic order, and he suggested it was time for South Carolina to rejoin the Union. All-white primaries told African Americans they could vote, but only if they took an oath stating they supported social, religious, and educational separation of the races. Waring believed this was inherently and constitutionally wrong, and ruled in Elmore v. Rice that all citizens of the United States shall be entitled and allowed to vote at all such elections, and informed the 93 white Democratic leaders that anyone who opposed that would be sent to jail.
And here was Judge Waring threatening to put them in jail to uphold the rights of black people to vote. It was stunning. And the reaction to that was pretty vociferous.
Dubbing him the lonesomest man in town, Collier's Magazine wrote, "Quiet Charleston is at war with one of its sons, a federal judge. A harsh, bitter war waged silently against men who were once friends. Breaking the barriers of voting was of great importance, but only one small part of gaining equality for all people."
He strongly felt that Plessy versus Ferguson was wrong. It was wrongly decided. It was a historic mistake. It was a legal mistake. It was an ethical mistake.
Waring knew that ultimately, Plessy versus Ferguson had to be overturned, and in the summer of fall of 1950, he began initiating a plan to place the Plessy question on the docket of the U.S. Supreme Court.
A young attorney for the NAACP by the name of Thurgood Marshall brought several civil rights cases before Judge Waring, asking for equal funding for black school districts. But Waring told Marshall, "You are aiming too low. Asking for the state to honor separate but equal does nothing but fuel inequality. Come back when you are ready to challenge segregation itself." Waring had been studying the Supreme Court and fully believed that if the court was presented squarely with the question of whether Plessy versus Ferguson was still good law, the doctrine of separate but equal would be overturned. Waring knew that such a challenge required a 3-judge panel, would lose 2-1, and that he would have the opportunity to write a dissent, the first judicial dissent from Plessy in 55 years. And Waring further understood that the case would skip the Court of Appeals and be automatically placed on the docket of the Supreme Court. The court would be forced, once and for all, to decide whether separate but equal was dead or alive. Thurgood Marshall found that case, and on December 22, 1950, he filed the first challenge to school segregation in American history, Briggs v. Elliott. Along with Judges Parker and Timmerman, Waring put himself on the panel and was finally staring down his barrel with a clean shot at Plessy versus Ferguson. After the trial, the judges adjourned. Timmerman held fast to the idea that the South had every right to segregate its school children and the U.S. Constitution had nothing to do with it, and Parker proposed that Plessy versus Ferguson remain the law of the land. Only Waring would not be swayed, and in his dissent, Waring argued, "Segregation in education can never produce equality. The system of segregation in the school system must go and must go now. Segregation is per se inequality." This concept had been presented to the Supreme Court before, in some variety, but Briggs v. Elliott was the first time the per se analysis was fully developed in a decision issued by a federal judge and would eventually become the main holding of Brown v. Board of Education.
He said segregation is per se inequality when nobody else in the country, no judge, was saying that. In fact, mostly no people of any kind were saying that.
Waring gamed the justice system and forced the highest court in the land to unanimously outlaw segregation in the 1954 ruling of Brown v. Board of Education.
The fight to desegregate schools ended at the highest court in the land, but it began in Charleston, South Carolina, with a white patrician judge, the son of a Confederate soldier, Julius Waties Waring. He would be threatened by racists and castigated by South Carolina politicians, including the threat of impeachment, and a resolution by the South Carolina court to remove him from the state. But he would not leave Charleston, or the bench, until he was finished. Judge Julius Waring became a voice for those who had been silenced and disenfranchised, breaking the barriers of institutionalized segregation and racial inequality in the U.S. If the courts of this land are to render justice under the laws without fear or favor, for all men and all kinds of men, the time to do it is now, and the place is in the elementary schools, where our future citizens learn their first lesson to respect the dignity of the individual in a democracy. The bold actions of Judge Waring in his dissent of Briggs v. Elliott sparked the civil rights movement and allowed a young Southern preacher to declare his dream, a passionate young attorney to rise to the highest court in the land, and students, all students, to aspire for any educational goal they deemed worthy.
The strategy is you must never surrender any of the rights you have gained, and you must look forward to the attainment of full equality.